Principal, how are you, sir? Congratulations on what you've done.
Governor Mike Hanson.
Yeah, the superintendent here. Good to see you. I'm really glad to be here. I look forward to our discussion.
Thank you for the school board for here for the chair. How long have you been on the school board?
6 years.
We're real excited to have Anderson on board president.
When I first got the call, I guess it was, you must be calling because our graduation rate improved.
So, Frank, if you want to go ahead and hit the next one. Historically, the school has been in the low 80% in terms of graduation. Not lower than that, but in 2006, that was when we first put on the small improvement list by the state.
Just to give you an idea where we are now, we've had three consecutive classes, 96%, 97%, and 97%.
Wow. And when did you first go on the list? What year did you tell me?
About 2006.
Okay.
So it's been a five-year list for us.
The first thing that we started looking at when we about 5 years ago is we knew we had to do something for our at-risk kids. And basically, that had to start with a focus on relationships. We knew that we had to really focus on staff to students. So we adopted this phrase here, we're going to tell really how much you care, except by just implementing a student on the front end here. But you'll see in front of you, and we've made some things for you to get a package. The first thing you'll see, and it'll just kind of start small, is there's a connecting with every student sheet. And that was something that we just started so that we would list students that we had a personal relationship or had a personal conversation with, and we could identify students that we were not.
And so somebody was literally combing the list to say, you know, nobody really seems to have known or talked with Judy Smith.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. We would go through the list and we would find every single student that was not represented, and then we would make an effort to make a contact, a personal contact relationship with them. And then we would revisit the list and see how we hit all these students.
Well, let me ask one more question. How many assistant principals?
Okay.
How many faculty members?
About 50.
Okay.
All right, the next slide. Basically, that was just the first step. But then we knew that we had to do interventions at grade level. And at first, we kind of did an entire school plan, but I'm just going to tell you right now, how you intervene with 9th graders and how you intervene with 12th graders are two different things. They're two different animals. So we began with the Freshman Academy Intervention Pyramid, and we'll go a little bit into that a little bit more later. But in front of you, you have a letter that we use with 10th and 11th grade students. See our positive behavior support team. It's at the top level. We actually send out that letter to the parents to identify kids and put them on a step 1, step 2, or step 3 plan in terms of intervening and making sure that they don't fall through the cracks.
And is this addressing behavioral issues or academic issues or both?
Well, when we started doing it, we used sort of a point system. We looked at their behavior and their academic.
Right.
And what it came down to was, right now, every single student that I know is missing two classes, failing two classes, will show up in the behavior and academic list.
Do you have some software that's helping you track that, or is that all done manually?
pretty much all done.
Okay. Well, entry, one of the ideas I want to talk about more with this group is that we've talked a lot about it, so that developing a dashboard that when you came in every day, you can identify every one of those students who missed two classes or who was this much behind, those kind of key indicators. I'd love to hear from you all what those key indicators should be.
Okay, excellent. And then 12th grade, you'll see a color-coded list on the next page. This is just a color that we've taken student names on. But you see, it has lots of colors. So that's because we found when you get to the 12th grade year, every single student needs to be identified one way or another, and then we have different interventions depending on the student. And you can be all the way to an intervention where, quite honestly, I might pick you up from school.
So we just found that by breaking it down by this,
it kind of fit more with the adolescent, their age, where they were in the progression.
Right. We talked about opportunities for struggling students, and basically, Frank, you want the next one. The first thing we realized was we couldn't access kids during the day for academic support. So one of the things we did was we made an open lunch period so that every teacher and every kid, every single day, have access to each other.
And what do you mean by open lunch period?
Basically, we have 8 periods, and one of the periods is 52 minutes in length. Right. During that period, we have 52-minute lunch. And the teachers are on lunch and the students are on lunch. But what happens?
You just have one lunch period?
We have one lunch period.
How do you do that? How do you feed 750?
Well, at first we thought it was going to be a problem, but it actually isn't. And when you walk around, the students can probably address it as well. They bring lunch to. What they did at first was they all ran to the cafeteria, but then they kind of realized, I don't have to run to the cafeteria. I can go maybe go get help over here or do something with Frank here and go, and when the line's down, you go 15 minutes in the lunch hour and you can walk right in and get your food.
Got it. Okay.
The other thing we did was we have two labs we call learning labs. Originally, we set them up for special education students, but now they're accessible to all students every period of the day. And that also provides extra support if someone is struggling in the class, and they can go down and get a smaller setting to be able to be successful. So those were kind of things at risk and struggling students, but we also knew long term we had to do something to connect kids to school. And so we created academies. And the first one we did, go ahead, Frank, is the Freshman Academy. Probably may have heard of this concept before, but it's about teachers taking control. Instead of being administrators in control of what's happening, they set the rules. They develop academic and behavioral pyramids, and it kind of takes the administrator out, and the teachers, they're on the ground floor. It gives them the power to be able to make decisions that can impact those kids. The second thing we did was we knew 10th through 12th graders needed to have connected curriculum. So some of the students you met this morning, some classes you're going to, they're in the Health Science and STEM Academy. Go ahead, Frank. And the goal was to connect classes that typically kids did not particularly like or enjoy, support, and connect it with an area of interest. So, for instance, in Health Science, you can see Ricky Jones over here.
I teach history, and I throw an emphasis on medicine, and I have a chemistry background also. Okay. I taught chemistry several years, so it was natural to go in. And when I teach world history, I make sure we, on the black bed, we talk about the causes, and if they had that come out today, how might you treat today? How did they treat it then? Right. And Civil War, we talk about medicine then, and today we're in the Depression, and the doctors in the black bag. And so we connect, and the teachers get a common planning period. We get to talk about the kids in the academy, and they know they can come to us. And we're with them for 3 years.
So at what point in time do I choose my academy?
Freshman year.
And everybody chooses an academy.
Well, right now it's you can choose the Health Science or STEM, or you can choose the regular path.
Okay.
Regular
path. I get it. Okay.
All right. And I kind of put those levels up. You go back for that, Frank. I put those levels up there because the first thing they want to focus on is the student. Then they focus on connecting their curriculum. And then they focus on some larger
That's
things.
Great.
The health science kids will probably tell you about disaster drill they put together for the school in the fall.
And it kind of brings it as an applied critical thinking, large scale item that they can use to apply their learning. All right, Frank, you go to the next one.
what percentage of your students are in each of those academies, and what percentage take the traditional track?
Well, in the sophomore year, we have about 60.
We have three classes of Health Science Academy, and in the juniors, we have one class.
Yep. So we're building.
It's building.
So we got 40%, I think, of our sophomores approximately are in Health Science Academy. About another 20% are in the STEM. So we have about 35 to 40 that are not in the academy.
Got it.
Once you start going down this path, then you also begin to
put a little humor up here, but you also get a little grades.
In particular, we're going to do just a little activity.
If you'll go to, you'll see you have a STEM and health science just for you there. Mm-hmm. But if you look at those first two progress reports I gave you, that have, I think it is, yes, it is Sue Taylor and Jim Smith. And you'll see that Jim there has an 84 average and Sue has a 71 average.
I won't put you exactly on the spot here, but I'll ask some other people that sort of used it.
We look at those and say, what can you tell us about the kids when you look at those? Mm-hmm. So, like, for instance, Ms. Lamb, what did you tell us about one of those students?
Looks like Jim Smith struggled in several of his test areas.
All right, so he struggled on tests, it looks like. Mr. Bass, what might you see from some of those students?
I also see that Jim Smith was very compliant and completed all of his homework assignments.
Okay, so he's compliant, completed his homework assignments. And we can keep going through those two, and what you'll hear is a lot of behavioral and general ideas. And that's what we're communicating to parents.
So, Frank, if you want to go to, not this slide, but go to the next one after this.
Look at the next two progress reports you have. These are for Major Lou and Rebecca Harvey. All right. If you look at those are based on a standards-based grading. They're set up by the state standards. Those categories of test, quizzes, homework are down, and now we have state standards. The reason we do that is, I'll put Mr. Stinson on the spot here. What might you tell me about one of those students?
I know that Rebecca needs to know how to solve equations with variables on both sides.
Okay.
So she does not do that very well.
She doesn't do that very well. All right. Mr. Tharp, can you tell me another thing you know about one of those two students?
Looks like the mathematics of chemical equations are giving me some trouble.
Okay. So the idea is there's a much different language being spoken.
Right.
Our parents, instead of coming in and us talking about behavior constantly, and it being sort of an argumentative approach back and forth, now we don't have that.
So if you go to the next one, Frank. What we have is we've changed from behavior in generalities to learning in specifics.
And I just put this. This was not an intention of making a book, but what we did as a staff was we knew people coming into our school as we moved forward here working on it need to know what they did. And then, so then we had some people say, well, let's just write a book for our new staff members. And then one of our staff members got a grant for $5,000 from NEA, and they put the book together for us. So like when we're talking about grades don't matter, it's because the traditional way of talking about grades doesn't give a lot of information to the kid or the parent about what exactly they're doing, exactly well, and where they're struggling. And so it's a flip to a standards-based approach that ties directly to the state standards. And so what we do at our school is, thanks to Dr. Looney and the county, they put together a scope sequence. Before, we were floundering a little bit. Our curriculum wasn't as strong, learning charges were counting up. We now have a much stronger and rigorous curriculum, and we can tie it to our grade.
Who sees this information?
Parents.
Parents see
parents,
this.
Parents, kids, teachers, learners.
So yes. Parent-teacher conference, you're willing to
do. Exactly. And now we're not talking about, the conversation goes from, well, Johnny just didn't behave that day. It goes to, Johnny doesn't know how to do this well, and we've got to figure out a plan so that he can do that better.
So one of the things I think that Christy and I are both the most interested in is how do we pull more parents into involvement with their child in school? Lessons from this for us?
Well, Yeah, like we might say, we might be in agreement of if he's struggling with two-step equations, but you might not have any idea of two-step equations. But we might say, okay, here's particular work we teach you to make sure that you practice your seminar. Even if you don't know how to do it, make sure they practice, come back to school, like we've got the open lunch. They can go back to their teacher, see their teacher for extra help. And the teacher might say, you know, you're not ready yet. Let me email your parent. I'll send some more home. You practice those. Then I'll reassess you. And so the grade is actually, the kids are never out of it, per se, because they know if they can learn something at a higher level, they can also improve that top right number, which that's what most of them are concerned
about. I didn't ask you this. You showed us your graduation rate. Is your college attendance rate increased commensurately?
Well, we've actually, because our graduation rate increased, our percent of college attendance actually decreased. Does that make sense?
Of your graduates, yeah, but of your total student body, I'm assuming that number has a
change. It's been rising every year. We're about 50% at four-year schools.
And what would it be countywide in Wiggs County? You know that number?
Above 70.
Above 70?
Yes.
And what would the graduation rate be?
Above 90.
And what's the overall reduced lunch percentage?
11%.
Okay.
Frank, do you want to go to the next spot? This is where we need to focus our school next. I just thought I'd talk about it. Once we've now got the kids here, we know how to keep them here. We know how to work them towards graduation, but now we have to move with the grading that we're doing and the curricula that the county has put together, we're now able to move to that next step. But the problem that we have is ACT and the information we get, for instance, from the state, we get information that tells us whether we're doing poorly, okay, or well. And then ACT sends us, you'll see that big stack, that big colored book, and they say, this is what you need to know. And they'll send us a report called Lynch Report that also tells us if we're doing poorly, mediocre, or well. And so we just need more information because our teachers can't go from that to knowing what an ACT question is.
Right.
So with the help of an outside company and a grant we got from the state, we have something called Pareto Analysis, and I put one in there for you, a sample student.
Like this?
Yes. And so our next step is that actually we can do an analysis that tells you exactly as a student and parent, and we do it school-wide, where a kid or a school needs to improve to move our composite 1 point, 3 points, or 5 points. And we have meetings with our parents, and you talk about parent involvement. We have meetings all the time, but we don't necessarily get a lot of parents to attend.
Right.
When we did this, we had 70%+ of our parents come.
Really?
Yeah.
From juniors?
Oh, junior parents. Okay. And we were going to do it with our freshmen and sophomore in the spring. And so that's the highest percent we've ever had in terms of parent participation to a single meeting on a topic. And they came and we gave them individualized information for the kindergarten. You'll see one of those sheets has a sample, has for this book in particular, has exact problems their son or daughter needs to work on. Not, you don't need to work the book. I think that student is, what's one of their top things they're for? Is it punctuation? So that student needs to work on punctuation problems.
Yes, punctuation.
So now they can go to this book, and we've already detailed out the exact problems they need to work on to improve punctuation. And our teachers know that punctuation in general.
I was going to say, then you can go back to teachers and say, you know, as a school, we've got an issue.
Exactly. So like Ricky can talk about the whole social studies department is working on applied ideas.
Right.
So that's a school-wide issue in terms of the ACT.
How are you compiling this information?
They give a
program that comes from ACT to get
them? No, ACT wouldn't want us to do that.
I was going to say.
Yeah. So basically, we took there was a company in New York we contacted, and as a partnership, we got the.
Is we here at you at the school?
This school. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And then we've moved it out to more schools in Williamson County are doing it, and Dr. Moon's working on that for the spring for every high school in Williamson County. But it's basically the kids take an ACT test, a retired ACT test, Right. And we send that off. They analyze it, and we'll send back this report for every individual kid, as well as the school-wide report. And then we can make decisions, and our teachers know the exact type of problems our kids are struggling on, so we can do instruction there. And kids and parents know. For instance, I gave you a 19.
Yeah.
Well, if I'm a 19 kid, what do I want to get?
Right.
21.
Right.
That's the money.
Right, exactly.
So I go down immediately, and the parent goes down, hey, you know how much it costs us? Costs us $9 a kid. Go to a different part of the county, you have parents paying $500, $1,000.
Right. Yeah.
So go to the next slide. This
Let me back up. You said something.
Back.
When 70% of the parents showed up, ultimately, is that because they're concerned that their child get the 21, so they get this? I mean, what's driving that?
And who are the 30% that didn't? Was it the 30% of the at-risk kids, or?
Well, it was mostly the kids that were scoring lower that their parents either aren't involved,
right,
or had said that their kid's not going to college,
right.
But we have all of our juniors in an ACT class, or 95% of them, basically, if your parent didn't show up, that didn't inhibit you from getting help. We still mandate
right.
that class if
Good.
You're working on your.
So, but back to my question, do you think the 70% was driven ultimately by parents that said, I really want my child to get 21 because I really want them to get the dollars?
I think it was driven by the fact that our juniors, as a school, we've been talking about the ACT consistently.
Right.
We've been building it up. And the fact that with the grant, we were able to give each parent a book along with the report. So if you came, you got all the resources necessary to make the difference.
That's cool.
Okay.
All right.
So I'd say the Pareto we kind of talked about is it's accessible to everyone, not just the financially able. All right. So that's pretty much what we talked about. This would be a great time to move back around and go into the discussion if you want to talk to me.
Yeah. Well, first of all, that was terrific. I mean, the reason we're here today is this. We obviously have talked a lot about focusing on education reform. But what I also know is there's a lot of great things happening around the state of Tennessee right now. And to me, you highlighted too. I mean, one of my firm beliefs is great principals make a difference because they're showing the initiative and going out and being aggressive about approaches. Number two, end of the day, relationships are what are key. And I love the fact that you're identifying those students that don't have relationships anywhere. And the third thing is you're using data to see what you're doing well and what you're not, and what each individual child is doing well and what they're not. So one of the things you can do from my position is take things that are working well and then spread it out across the state as we build not just a legislative program, but the administrative program of the state, and as we try to help spread, like I said, good practices around the state. So that's why we're here today, and this has been incredibly helpful and impressive to me.
Well, we'll move the chairs around.
Okay. I guess maybe Mr. Superintendent, let me ask you a question. What are the things that I believe that quality of the institution is about quality of their leader. I think it seems like you have a great one here. What are the things you can do from the system to help when they take kind of new initiatives and, hey, we think we'll try this, whether it be the new approach to ACT or whatever, and then how do you take the learnings from here and spread it to other places?
Well, first, support innovation, and the Pareto analysis that Dr. McDonald was talking about has now been applied to all of our high schools, so we're doing that. We encourage experimentation, but also we as a district have started looking at what we call the 3 R's. River.
Right.
We believe that if you survey our students, even in some of our highest performing schools in our district, our students will tell you that we still aren't challenging to the extent that we challenge. And so we're focusing on how do we make our curriculum offering more involved kids. The second part is what you spoke to in that relationship.
Right.
We understand that success is contingent upon our ability to perform positive, strong, effective relationships with board members. So we have a lot of schools experimenting. fluent system such as we're in, or if you're from a poor system where I came from.
Where were you before?
I was in Alabama. Served at the assistant superintendent of the school, the daughter of the state, and obviously in a small rural.
Okay.
High poverty and high,
Yeah.
So relationship is key. And then finally, it's relevance. And I think that if you talk to the staff and teachers and to the students, one of the things that we have been struggling with is breaking down the two silos that exist. If you think about the schooling experience, schooling is from 8 to 3 in a visual setting, but that doesn't resemble real life for boys and girls.
Right.
And so the challenge we have is how do we make that resemble real life? Because what we know is that when learning is relevant to the students' lives, that they apply it and they keep it to their reading. So really focusing on those three things and supporting our schools in their efforts to make those three things become more of a reality than they are.
I can hear from them. There's a great place of people, both principal, school board folks. I'm assuming a lot of your parents as well. So, well, what are the things that I want to go back to the question we talked about with increasing parental involvement? What are the things? What other things are you seeing that are working that it might be good for me to hear about?
We need more parental involvement. That's what I say. I mean, we have a little problem with that in this area. With him mentioning 70%, that was great. But we need more parents to get involved. I'm also the athletic director here. And you know, just on Friday nights, I need as many parents. And they do come for the football games, but you know how it is. We're always begging for help, right? And that's a good question. I would like to hear,
particularly like the at-risk students, that those 30 in Chrissy's question, I was great. That's a obviously statewide issue for us.
I think some of the time, the top at-risk mentioned on some of those kids, Haslam, that's where you have to actually. It's not necessary, they're not necessarily coming to you. We're going to reach out to that. But obviously, we can't drive 100 homes.
Right.
So, but if you had the resources, you might be able to make that decision and just to get them to go. And then having things that they are deeming as meaningful and feel like they're getting something productive out of school. If I just pass out, your son or daughter is not doing well, but don't give them anything that they can do with it.
Right.
They're not going to do a lot of interaction.
Got it.
Think about equipping parents. It's rare for us to meet a parent that doesn't want their child to succeed.
Yeah.
And the challenge is, how do we equip parents to be more informed and more engaged in what Dr. Donan and this particular faculty have done, is they have focused on the great analysis and ACT. You asked the question about, is it the money?
Right.
I haven't met a parent yet that doesn't want their child support putting on the ACT.
Right. That's
the college.
No question.
So the reality is many parents don't know how to help there. And so what schools are doing is they're beginning to equip parents with resources and tools that will assist them as parents to have their child be successful in school. So it's about equipping them more rather than the traditional PTO meeting, you know, here's the minutes of the meeting, listen to us, we're going to talk and you will listen. All the homes, rather than doing that, and we're interacting with them and interfacing with them, trying to equip them with tools.
Right.
Another thing, the technology is a way too, and we are reaching out more. Carol Birdsong is here, and she's the one who calls out for snow and things like that, and I think she's got a YouTube video about her. So there is that connection. You know, me.
So we're out tomorrow. We're going to come to school or not?
Not looking good right now.
How that work?
Or, Twitter. I know the county is putting out a Twitter account, and I think that makes connections better, so technology is one way we're getting the connection.
I do think I work a lot with the at-risk students, right, especially the older ones. And I do think the relationship between with the parents is important, because a lot of those at-risk parents with those students didn't like school themselves. They're unfamiliar. They think schools are unfriendly sometimes.
Right.
So So we try really hard here, I think, to make connections with the parents as well, to be on their side. So we really want your son or daughter to graduate from high school. How can we help you at home do those things? And I know what Mr. Dunn mentioned, we've gone to houses and things like that, but making connections with parents as well.
Let me ask you, one of the things, the state obviously was, incredible, fortunate to receive the Race to the Top funds, and all of us are, one of the concerns we have is let's make certain we use those wisely, and also in a way, and something like Jackson made a point of, this is one-time money that's coming, and just don't build dependency on it, we're not going to have. So one of the things that's been a defensive focus on, I think we can do better, is the whole using a better kind of, in business, what I'd call just an information management system of, here's the key criteria, here's the key numbers, or the key indicators that you have of how a child is doing, and make that easily accessible to a teacher and school administrator. Kind of curious as to whether you all think that's something that will be real helpful or not, so that every day when you turned on your desktop, it said, here's the 10 students that, that are, falling behind in this class, that do show a troubling absentee pattern, that do, that aren't on track to graduate, whatever those indicators would be. Is that something that, developed would be really helpful?
I'll let the assistant principal answer because they're nodding before you even got done.
I imagine somebody's putting a whole lot of work into a couple of these sheets that I saw.
We all have a list, either a written list or a mental list of the students we need to see that day.
Right.
And the things that you're talking about are the reasons why they show up on these lists. So that would be fantastic. If I could turn on my computer in the morning and the list is already made for me.
Right.
Oh, those are the 10. I got it. Now I can see those guys.
And it would be great to make that accessible to teacher teams as well.
Yeah, the freshman academy.
Yeah, the whole point about data is to let them. Okay. Well, that's helpful to hear.
As a district, we're actually working on that dashboard.
Are you good?
We're 15 years behind.
Yeah.
Probably the whole city.
Yeah.
And our ability to access data.
Yeah. In Knox County, where I was mayor in Knoxville, we actually, our chamber basically, Chamber of Commerce basically sponsors that, and we have a program that's just about ready for prime time, and it's every educator that's used it said, boy, you just saved me an hour a day. What else? We're going to run out of time because I really do want to go tour. I think we're going to get a tour of the academy, so I want to do that. But what else for being open mic? what would you want to tell me, or and Jack and Chrissy, what are things that you, hey, from where we sit, those of you who work up there on Capitol Hill, here's some things we wish you understood better.
Mr. James?
I've talked a bunch. I kind of do a little bit.
Well, I think if you were to survey teachers, the biggest hurdle they're going to have is time.
Right.
And probably get everywhere you go. And I think one of the benefits of the Common Core curriculum is when it was introduced was the idea of focusing on depth versus breadth. And that so much of what we need to do as far as building those connections is using brain research and building relevance, making those applications requires time.
Right.
And I think so often we confuse more with better.
Right.
And I think we should really look at, as we unveil these new standards, and we've received accolades across the country for Tennessee standards, making sure that we're focusing on what do they need to know, and how do we make sure that it's taught and assessed. And I really think the way we change classroom instruction is the way we assess them. The students, that's going to drive what they're doing. And if we do a good job of unveiling an assessment model that focuses on breadth and connections and relevance, and then I think there's more likely chance of kids buying in to not just regurgitating, focusing on getting caught on stuff.
Right.
I chime in two things. As the director of schools and as school administrators and teachers, we can't wait until January to get all types of data. We need that data in a timely fashion. I know that this year was an anomaly, but
right.
we need the data in a timely fashion so that we can plan instruction program. The other part about it is an autopsy result is after the fact.
Patients already did.
We need formative assessment tools so that we can gauge our performance and make that in our progress along the year.
And help those of us who are non-professional educators, what would those formative assessment tools look like?
Perfect world.
Right.
Sitting from my perch, we would have formative assessment data that would happen on a quarterly basis that would do two things. One, it would look back on what we had just taught to determine mastery and what has to be retaught because it's a scaffolding curriculum that builds on one kind of the other. And then it would pretest on material that you're about to teach. Much of our schools today, every time is wasted on teaching things that some of our students already know. And it doesn't allow us, it doesn't give us the information to empower instruction to differentiate. So my view would be it would be a look in the rear view mirror from the last 9 weeks, but it would also be a pretest of the upcoming 9 weeks so that we can make instructional decisions. Okay.
Got it.
And just to follow up with that on what I said earlier, I think high quality assessment items, the teachers have to scramble to create their own quality assessments because they may get some resources from a textbook and may be able to use things here and there. But if we want to really create high quality assessments that on the front end, which is what we're supposed to do, that we create before we get our units, and that requires us to apply and use information, they're spending an inordinate amount of time creating these assessments from scratch. And they really can't get their hands on it.
Got it.
And if we can, and that's, if we really want to impact, you know, have an impact with school reform, you start with those assessments. You know, a lot of educational researchers have been saying this, you know, we've got to focus on these, got to make those high quality. Then we have those in hand ready to go, and then that will positively impact daily instruction. So that's really important.
And let me, yeah, I really, this, we don't have time to get into this, unfortunately, but does that give you then more confidence in using that as a way to evaluate how well teachers are doing?
Absolutely.
So you would have, okay.
Absolutely.
You have a lot more confidence in taking that next step if you had the high quality assessments.
Correct.
And the teachers would appreciate having things timely with the high quality. So if they don't have to take their time to make those,
right.
Plus it's prescriptive,
yeah.
Then I can do something about it rather than
just. Are your better assessments out there? They just cost money? Or are they not out there? That's why they're making money.
Dan?
Well, I was going to say, basically they're just making money because they don't have access. For instance, you can say, here's the state standard, and here's an exact test.
Right.
For them to be able to, it's like giving them that chart right there.
Right.
I make your test. That's the problem.
Yeah, I get it.
And the problem with the, you know, many of them is that they are a lower level. And that it almost reinforces what we're trying to get away from, which is this lower level recall. And if you really want to test the ability to think and apply what they're learning to new scenarios and novel questions, we're going to need tools like reading passages. And then asking kids to read novel reading passages they haven't seen, and can they apply those main idea on author's purpose and inference skills for things they haven't seen. It's very easy to handle and rote questions, but that's not what's going to change the structure.
There are box assessment systems out here that I'll term it as a loose alignment to the Tennessee standards. So generally what the assessment companies do is they have an assessment bank of questions and then they try to align those questions to the standards of a particular state or a school system. But those alignments are relatively loose and broad.
Yeah.
And so they're not real tight, and it doesn't allow us to have a lot of confidence in whether there's predictive validity on that on the assessment to that to something.
Speaking of, excuse me, to schools, but as chamber president and working with the community service, I would like to see the children see a pride of ownership in our community of Fairview.
Right.
I believe that they care; they may not know how to access. So we are trying to work with more community service opportunities to open the doors for the high school, middle school, and elementary school, whether it be on their grounds or the community as a whole.
And I believe that pride of ownership will keep them invested in our community versus them seeing, you know, outside areas of more interest. And I believe if we can keep the children looking into the community of Fairview and then being able to do maybe model business and be able to have mentors in the business realm, not only do they see that they can make a difference, whether they go off to college and come back, but they can make a difference in the future. Also, I feel like our adults need to be challenged to encourage excellence, not average. And I believe that's something that we can really focus on as each and every one of us want children to do their very best. And I know that the state is focusing on IT for the future needs of the IT business that's right. coming and working with the economic and community development. You know, they're working with the eighth grades to get them more engaged in the IT across the state. So I feel like that's something as a city of Fairview as well as a chamber of commerce, we can support the kids focusing on that. And then you ask for a need, a wish list, the need for more, the need for healthy family entertainment in our community. There's not much for the children to do. Football games are great, but there's not much for the children to do in the city of Fairview, and we'd like to focus more on that as well.
Well, we're going to
think we're going to say some time to tour, so thank you all very much. Very
thank you.
Are you all juniors, seniors? So what is there? What class are we in?
Chemistry.
And there's a teacher, Ms. Beard?
Isn't that Beard?
Oh, hi. Hey, I'm Dale. Nice to see you. So tell us maybe overall kind of where you are and what you're trying to do.
So right now in our learning targets, we're studying chemical bonds, and part of our learning targets would be to get them to look at the properties of the bonds. So they went to lab, and they looked at the different, about 7 or 8 different properties of the chemical bonds, and now they're trying to predict the structure. I'm not going to tell them what the structure looks like. They're trying to predict what the structure is.
So everybody in here chose the STEM Academy path, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, not enough. Okay, this is your chemistry class that's part of the
STEM Academy. We have one or two that are not in STEM, okay. but most are
okay.
in STEM.
Yes. Okay, and for those who chose, let's say, the STEM route, why did you do that? Why did you decide to go this way?
Technology and engineering and stuff like that.
Hopefully you want to go. Okay. What about other folks? Why did you choose this path? Anybody?
I think it's not relevant to the major.
Relevant to the major? I'll come back. Relevant to the major you're choosing?
Yeah.
You mean that you're going to choose in college?
Yeah.
So you already have a sense that this is what I'm going to college. This is the best path to college. Okay. Is this harder? Harder than the end chosen system academy? Just workload wise or not?
Problem.
You tell your parents it is anymore? I'm sorry.
A lot of times there's extra projects added into the academy to integrate the technology into that.
That
normal
classes
wouldn't get opportunity to
have extra
field trips and projects to
still
further.
Okay. And Dr. Dunn,
when
did the academy start?
This is more in our second year.
Oh, really? Oh,
yes.
Okay. What else should I know about what you guys are doing?
Why did y'all choose that?
Well, I want to just see if I can get a
comment,
so I thought I could
be. Okay.
Do
you know what you want to do?
I want to be a nurse.
Okay.
To the right.
No.
Are you both?
Actually, which one? I heard both. Okay. We'll follow you as a trusted leader.
What kind of class, what's different, different classes or just different approach? They just try to teach us more. Like in our English class, we'll read books on diseases or plagues, and then in history class, Mr. Jones says, and we did other things like that. So it's really interesting to see. It really makes it interesting in those classes that are normal classes.
And then we have an extra class, and it's called bias class.
Okay.
And then we get to learn about like diseases in the body and stuff like that in presentations and learn more about health.
This is Mr. Joseph's room. It's a history class.
Okay.
Are you going here?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So, first of all, thank you for letting me interrupt your class. Tell me how this is a history class is part of the Health Science Academy, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. So, give me an example of how what you're doing in history relates to being in the Health Science Academy. Anybody? Anybody want to be involved? Sorry to bring all these TV cameras into your normal quiet classroom. Michael?
Yesterday we read an article about a doctor.
Okay.
Okay.
Anybody else? Well, let me ask you a first question. What made you choose the Health Science Academy?
The teachers.
No. Anybody? I mean, you didn't have to do this. Anybody?
Does that work?
Okay. Okay. How many of you think you'll end up being this career? I know it's unfair to you might not know you, but how many of you think that, yeah, you might end up in some sort of health science field? Most of you? That's impressive. Okay. Good.
Well, that makes it more interesting, too. Does it make it more interesting because if you have an interest in health science, then hearing about that doctor kind of makes the whole lesson come alive.
And they get to know each other pretty well. They've been together, this is your second year together.
How many sophomores are in the health science?
This is juniors.
Oh, these are juniors. Okay. Juniors, and how many juniors are in the academy?
This is it.
This is why class
relationships. Using data to intervene uniquely. That's what we're missing in some of these groups.
It feels like you said, we're going through a bunch of stuff to try and get to the
meeting. Yeah.
Well, I think we should go this way.
I guess those guys are going this way. Yeah.
We're with him.
All right.
Yeah. National Newsweek ranking, what year was that?
We're still ranking it.
Really?
Four consecutive years, top 1,000. Basically, it's AP participation, advanced
okay.
participation.
Okay.
And about 4 years ago, just before that, we didn't offer a lot of advanced courses for our kids.
Okay.
What class is this?
This is a health science class.
So what?
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for letting us invade your class.
Okay.
Tell us, my name is Bill Haslam. My wife, Chrissy, Senator Jack Johnson, who's your state senator. And we're just here to understand the school a little better. We heard a lot of the great things that are happening here, from improved graduation rates to improved college attendance rates. And really wanted just to get a personal view of what's going on. So tell us what we've heard about the academy. Tell us what you're doing right now. I assume you're not just like on Facebook and listening to music.
Right now we are using an online program called insightmedical.org, and we're learning general information about the body and different directions, motions, and planes, and just all about the joint in our feet and our hands and stuff like that.
Okay. I'm sure. Okay. Are you all juniors or
sophomores?
And you all are all in Health Science Academy? And what made you choose doing this?
Pursue medical career.
Would that be true of everybody in here? You think I'm going to end up?
Mm-hmm.
How many of you have a family member in the health field of one kind or another? Interesting.
Is this the class that you take, sort of the extra class you take as a health?
They really are not this shy.
I was
going to
say. I'm sure not.
Is most of this class on your laptop? Is it sort of
on that?
No.
Are the laptops here part of this classroom or what?
You one of you want to explain that?
Yeah. Sure.
They go throughout and help my classes.
All right, well, thank you all very much. We're on a little bit of a faster schedule than I would like, but thank you for letting us come in, and congratulations on what you're doing.
You're on a great path, that's right. Maria, Jack and I are getting older. Thank you very much. Yeah, we met when we walked in.
He's the vice president, right?
Yeah, sure.
Are there any other questions you have for us?
See which way we go.
Front office.
I'm heading back to the front door. So you're a senior junior. How'd you get to be vice president junior?
You don't have to be a senior to be the president.
Technical school is right.
We have junior.
Right.
You can run as a state to be elected. So I was elected and
tried. Tell me about your day here and why you came.
It's no secret we're going to talk a lot and work a lot on education reform. But if you're going to do that, you need to know that a lot of good things are happening in Tennessee right now. And this is a school that's dramatically improved their graduation rate. And they've done it, I think, how that's going to happen a lot of places. They have a great leader in place as a principal who's very aggressive about initiating things. Number two, they understand it's about relationships. They're committed to not letting any child fall through the cracks, and they have programs in place to track that. And number three, they're using the data that they have to measure real progress. And those are all things we want to do. So as governor, while I talk about how committed we are to improving education in Tennessee, we don't want to forget the fact that we're doing a lot of great things, number one. And number two, one of the things I can do is help spread practices that are working from one place to another.
How did you pick Williamson County as your first school stop?
I think we actually started out looking around the state for schools that had shown dramatic improvement, and this is a school that had shown that, and so we're going to keep doing that. And one of the things I'm going to try to do is, you know, it's dangerous when you're a politician to always be pontificating on education when you have full-time educators who are spending all their time. So one of the things we want to do is get a lot of input, and we're going to be doing that on a regular basis. And it happened that Fairview was a great place for us to start.
One thing I noticed different is your wife's sitting next to you. How do you plan to use your wife?
Well, Chrissy, you know, the office of First Lady, you can use for a lot of different things. One of the things Chrissy wants to focus on is education. Particularly, I think she's going to look a lot at how we encourage more parents to be involved in education. And Chrissy has her master's in education-related field, and very interested in that, and wants to help.
Governor Haslam, as you continue talking about education reform, one, what did you learn here today that will help you? And two, what role do you see charter schools possibly playing?
Well, what I learned today is, I've said all along that great principals make all the difference, and those principals who are being active and initiating change. Number two, I think they have a really creative system. They're doing it all manually in terms of tracking kids who might be at risk. But I think that's it, that they've isolated, okay, where do we have opportunities to do better, and what children are struggling. They've done a great job of identifying them. They're doing it all manually. I think one of the things we might be able to do statewide is, do we have a data management system that can help things that students, teachers, administrators are spending hours working on? Can we come up with a management information system that would make all that easier? So we had a discussion about that, and it's something that we've worked on some in Knoxville in the past, and I think we're going to try to see if we can do that statewide.
You had a lot of questions today about the graduation rate and where they're going on here, and the ACT score, whether it was getting the 21 and the money.
Right.
So how does this visit relate to higher education as well?
Well, it's a great question. Ultimately, one of the issues we have is Tennesseans, again, I haven't made any secret of this, is far too small a percentage of our population over the age of 25 has a degree. Now, college is not for everybody. I'll be really clear there. But it needs to be for more Tennesseans than it's been for in the past. And so when you see an increased graduation rate here, an increased college attendance rate, that we're trying to, let's track that, see what are we doing to make that happen.
One more, guys. Governor, the discussion in the legislature has been about changing tenure rules, perhaps vouchers and charter schools.
Right.
What sort of package do you envision being?
Yeah, and we obviously will come to that. I mean, I do think tenure is something that we should talk about.
That's it.
Sorry. I think great teachers want to be treated like professionals, and with tenure, we don't give our doctors and lawyers tenure. And so I understand why tenure exists, but I think we should have a conversation about what the right path for that is going forward. Charter schools, I think, are an important component of what we're doing in Tennessee. We've loosened the regulations that allowed us to have more charter schools, and I'd like to see us maybe loosen those even more, because I think we are having success with charter schools.
And vouchers?
I think vouchers are an interesting concept. Ultimately, I believe that. I don't, right now, given the focus where we are, I don't think you'll see a lot of initiative from us this year out of vouchers.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you all for coming. I appreciate you being here. Thank you all for coming. I appreciate it.